Shri Tathagata Satpathy.
Sir, 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 this is not good. That house is not in order. Why you are saying it?
आप लोग कृपया बैठ जाइए, हाउस ऑर्डर में आ जाएगा.
सर, थैंक यू वेरी मच.
आप सब लोगों की भी जिम्मेदारी हाउस को ऑर्डर में रखने की है.
अपॉर्चुनिटी टू इनिशिएट द बजट 2019.
केवल केवल तथागत जी की बात ही जाएगी.
दैट इज नॉट इन ऑर्डर एंड वेयर सम पीपल आर सेइंग दैट I don't know. They are saying that Satpathy sit down. They are saying Chowkidar chor hai. Luckily, they are saying Chowkidar chor hai. They are not saying I am chor. That is very nice. And I would like to assure friends that it has nothing personal against them. Spiritually, mentally, and in every which way. We agree with certain things that you say, but the ganging up here is possibly not acceptable to anybody, because this is probably not the way that parliamentary democracy should be functioning, and I hold both sides responsible for this kind of a situation. Earlier, I am told, we are all told, that during the freedom struggle against the white rulers, there was a cry in this North Indian language of Hindi which said, Mujhe khoon do, main tumhe azadi dunga. It meant, give me blood and I will give you freedom. When on 1st of February 2019, I was listening to the budget speech of the finance minister, I was very inspired by the underlying motto that Mujhe vote do, main tumhe paisa dunga. It's a pity, sir, and I do not hold any one party, I do not hold just the BJP responsible for the plight of India today. I hold the Congress and I hold many of the regional parties also, which have held power in different states of the Union through a period of time since independence. The way all of us have contributed in ensuring that our farmer, our farmland, and the spirit of India remains neglected. However, since our present life is what is being is what is in memory, fresh memory, we all realize that this 5 years or 4.5, 4 years, 8 months that have passed by, our dear Minister Piyush ji and the others would be aware that all that this government of yours has done is actually completely follow in the misdeeds and the bad modus operandi of the Congress. We have to understand that the people of this country are smarter than all of us. They rejected the country hoping, they rejected the Congress hoping the country will be saved from the evils of the Congress. But lo and behold, you were no better. All that you did in the last 4 years, 8 months, 9 months, is follow exactly in their footsteps. And if you go and scan, anybody who cares, to scan all the bills that you have passed, all the new laws that you have made in this country, they have all focused on changing the company affairs law, changing the banking system, your demonetization, your so-called drive against black money, your so-called one nation, one tax. Everything that you have done has been aimed at only the super big industrialists. You have not bothered to find out, to feel one, with the toiling masses of India. You have never bothered to check what does the farmer want. Did the farmer at any given point of time in the history of this country, did the farmer ever possess one single rupee of black money? So who were you fighting against? You were not fighting against anybody. You had your plan B. You had your electoral bonds lined up so that when you do this, you cripple your political adversaries and you take up issues where alone you shall be the richest party and everybody else will be a beggar. Similarly, as you are trying to make your political adversaries beggars, you have also made the farmers beggars. Do you think that when you are doling out 2,000 rupees every 4 months or 6,000 rupees in a 12-month period to a farmer, do you think that will suffice to help him survive? A farmer is compelled to commit suicide when he realizes that he has nowhere else, nobody that he can go to. And what do? You give him 2,000 rupees, which probably does not even fill in diesel, a full tank for a tractor, which if it runs 2 days in his fields of 2 hectares, which is a base minimum you have taken, the tractor will not have enough diesel also to plow the fields. So are you trying to say that the farmer is a beggar, that you are giving him alms, you are giving him bhiksha?
Very good point.
This is something that troubles me, because apart from your abilities, you have now taken for granted that power will be yours. Power will always be with the rich, with the educated, with the so-called elites. And you do not believe that the power lies right down at the ground level. It is another matter that for the past 10 years in the last two Lok Sabhas, when we were all there, we saw a prime minister who never had ground reality, who was elected he was not even elected to the Lok Sabha, he could not come into the Lok Sabha, a prime minister ruling this country from the Rajya Sabha. Today also, we see a bulk of our people, and no personal affront to anyone, a bulk of the senior responsible ministers of this cabinet are from the Rajya Sabha, whereas we have all these capable people of the Lok Sabha sitting here who could have easily taken up the reins of this country, who are rooted in the ground level of India, who understand the problems, who face people on a day-to-day basis. They are ignored in this government just as they were ignored in the last government. The farm crisis, we have to admit, is for real. Let nobody misguide us. And like I said earlier, yes, I admit, it is not a recent phenomenon. It is not something that you have started, but you have continued it with vigor, just like the Congress had done it. It is time for the whole governance system to understand that farming needs much more than a 2,000 rupee or a 6,000 rupees dole. Your neglect, the ruling elite of India has neglected farms for so long that we have forgotten what is the importance of water in the fields for a farmer. We have forgotten how does a farmer access proper seeds at the correct time. We have no idea of what kind of scientific or technological backup the farm sector deserves that productivity can go up. How can they be competitive worldwide with organic food being produced in India? In your this budget speech, you have bravely mentioned about India making, let me quote para 77, making India self-sufficient in food exporting to the world to meet their food needs, and producing food in the most organic way in the is the eighth dimension of our vision. Your visions might be fantastic, but what have you done in the last 5 years apart from giving this dole? And when you start, talking in the Para 68 vision for the next decade, you have said, we have resolved many problems which were coming in the way of realizing our full potential as a society and an economy. I would like to challenge the government. I would like to challenge the governance system of this country. What social or economic problems have you addressed? Apart from trying to help those crony capitalists who are your friends, what have you done for the MSMEs? What have you done for the startups? Apart from levying angel tax, which has made nearly about 48% of them sick and virtually leaving this country, you have done nothing for startups, you have done nothing for small businesses, you have done nothing for small enterprises either. You only talk now, somebody has told you, now you talk about job creation. But how do you expect people will create jobs if you do not encourage them right from the beginning? You have virtually scrapped the 5-year plan. The 12th 5-year plan, which was from 2012 to 2017, has died a natural death. No country can possibly grow if there is no mid-range and long-range planning of growth. You have stopped the 5-year planning system and no one is discussing it. You have no vision documents for 15 years, nor is your 3-year action plan have any structured route map. The 3-year document also has no financial powers, has only a broad roadmap to the government. It is toothless because it has no financial powers. Since it needs no cabinet approval, its recommendations are not binding on government. It reminds me of something like the Press Council of India, which is supposed to monitor the media and to control the media, but it is virtually powerless. It is a deep-seated, I find, sir, it is a deep-seated concept in India that the economic pie is fixed. Our system probably believes the resources are limited, and that limited wealth is derived solely through taxation. In reality, a nation like India has unlimited resources. It has unlimited resources in the form of human abilities. Sadly, our populace has been rendered lethargic and unproductive due to historical ills. More sadness dawns on us when we realize that even today, instead of rectifying the past mistakes, our elected leaders have opted for conveniently blaming the past. That is all that we are listening to in this house. Always, even after 5 years, you are still blaming the Congress. And you are not progressing beyond blaming. A time has come that you should stop blaming. I was very sad to listen to this to the Honorable Prime Minister yesterday. Sir, I need time. I'm the first speaker. I need time, sir.
You have got only 10 minutes, sir.
I was very sad to hear the Prime Minister yesterday, because all that he did was a self-defense exercise of blaming the Congress. Now, the people had voted you in 2014 to break the rut, to break the evil of the Congress. So by blaming them, you have not done anything good for the country. Rather, it is necessary that we get out of the old mindset and create a system where we don't blame each other, but we think of the nation.
I adjourn to meet again 2 p.m.
Yes, madam.
Tathagata Satpathy. Yes. Tathagata Satpathy ji bol rahe the.
Ji madam. Thank you, ma'am. And I will not take too long.
What is it? What you want to say? So what to do? She has already, defense minister has already replied, no. Now nothing, every now and then not the same thing you are going to discuss. Yes?
May I start?
You can.
Madam, thank you for giving me this opportunity. I will wind up quickly. I have only two more points to make.
Yes.
And the first is to continue where I had ended earlier. Yes, I firmly believe that this dole of 500 rupees a month or 6,000 rupees a year, or if we calculate 7 rupees a poultry, 7 rupees a day, is definitely not what the Indian farmer wants or deserves. All you could come up with is a kind of old age pension. Even a tractor tank will not be filled with this 7 rupees a day. That is the best that your brilliant brains could produce. Do you know why you were so very unimaginative? It is primarily because you and your whole governance system has lost touch with ground realities. You talk of creating a digital India.
You should not disturb. I'm sorry.
As if this is your first budget and you are laying out a projected path for the next 5 years. Even in this, you have not focused on agriculture. All your digitization efforts have been urbane and not in any manner helpful to the farmer. The farmer is not a beggar. He toils for his livelihood. He does not want your alms. Similarly, you might boast to please the middle class that you have given them a tax exemption of 5 lakhs per annum. But madam, we are all aware that if somebody gets even 10 rupees above 5 lakhs, the whole 5 lakhs will come under the tax tax system. So, is that justified, and will it really help the middle class, the SSC? And on the other hand, see how contradictory your own statements are. You are giving a 10% reservation to the EBC, the economically backward class of the upper castes, and you are keeping a cut-off mark of 8 lakhs as their annual income. So therefore, with this kind of a reservation, will the beneficiaries of this reservation be taxpayers? So you are constantly contradicting yourself. And madam, I would like to wind up my speech in 1 minute, my talk. The rise of this regime in 2014 general elections in India was the beginning of a global trend of Western-style democracies moving to the right of the political spectrum, fueled by radical far-right political bases. Erdogan in Turkey, the Brexit vote, Trump's election, Duterte in Philippines, and recently elected Bolsonaro in Brazil are some examples. Signs of the radical far-right strengthening are there even in France and Germany, not to mention many other countries. This clearly indicates that centrist voters or progressive, the poor people, were caught sleeping, and the agenda of the radical far-right base is taking over. In all of this, we were not able to spot the trends of rising fascism. Where we see it is actually threatening many of the powerful democracies around the world. And some of the early warning signs are powerful and continuing nationalism, 2, disdain to recognize human rights, 3, identifying enemies, scapegoats as a unifying cause, like whoever eats whatever meat, controlled electronic, print or social media, obsession with national security, intertwining religion and government, extension of protection to corporates, suppressing labor power, disdain for intellectuals and arts, obsession with crime and punishment, rampant cronyism and corruption, and last but not least, fraudulent elections. So this country is in a stage of flux. We are in a bad situation. And had it not been, I must thank the people of Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, and Chhattisgarh for taking such a decisive action and telling the people that, telling the nation that they are sick and tired of the right, they are sick and tired of the rich and the powerful ruling them. Their answer does not lie with the Congress, madam. The Congress is not the answer. But due to the lack of a third alternative, the people had to throw out the ruling dispensation and opted for the opposition. So the Congress now has to live up to what it says. It has to commit here before the end of this session that if they come to power, they will undo the damages to the farmers. They will undo Aadhaar. They will undo GST. They will have to simplify GST. They will undo the damages to the national economy that occurred due to demonetization. And they have to bring a law that no one single person in this country should be able to play with the currency of the country. And many laws need to be changed. The Congress will have to commit if it wants to be in power next time. Otherwise, this Mahagathbandhan, as the Prime Minister was speaking, will become a Mahagathbandhan. That is what it will be. The people will not trust an untrustworthy Congress, and the people will not trust an untrustworthy BJP. Both have been damned. Thank you for the opportunity, ma'am.